favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Welcome to a special presentation with Mike and
or
Elf will not be seen tonight.
Okay, it is now post-Thanksgiving, and it's time to start thinking about those the specials that they ran after Thanksgiving to keep the kids from driving the adults crazy while they were lying around bloated and drunk. And you know, you can't yet get the kids bloated and drunk, try as we might. So we have to instead put them in front of the Garfield Thanksgiving special and the Peanuts Thanksgiving special, and there's basically no other Thanksgiving specials. Which is what led one of my local TV stations when I was a kid to get a little creative. So
so this is
they showed? Did I tell the story on the show?
I don't remember. So tell it again, because it's more relevant this time.
Yeah. So I watched so when I was in like second or third grade, after Thanksgiving, I watched the Garfield special and the Peanuts special. And when I got back to school, everyone was talking about how they watched the Peanuts special and then Tubby the Tuba. And I was like, how did this happen? Apparently they had all watched it on like an independent station while I watched like the CBS version of Garfield and Charlie Brown.
So some other channel was like, we got the Peanuts special, but we can't get Garfield. So tell me the Tuba.
We got something fat. That's good enough, right?
Yes, it's our fat little friend, Tubby the Tuba.
Tubby the Tuba. Raise your hands if you already know and love Tubby the Tuba. I see no hands.
I had not heard of Tubby the Tuba prior to this. And I'm not sure why they would decide to show this on Thanksgiving. Oh, wait. It's because Tubby learned to be grateful for...
Oompa?
Yeah, I got nothing.
Actually,
Tubby learned nothing in this, honestly.
The Wizard of Oz?
Oh, no. Did something just happen?
No. Hello? Hello? Uh-oh.
Oh, can you hear me?
Uh-oh. I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah. What's going on?
Oh. Nothing. I didn't do anything. Did you do something?
No, I just heard a weird ding, and I thought that, like, you dropped out or something. But looks like you didn't. You're still here.
No. Okay. And well, now we have something to be thankful for.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Whew. Yeah, I'm sure thankful for this modern technology, which allows a... I like how it's like we're living in 2023. We basically have, like, Star Trek communicators and shit, but, like, we're just whining about, like, oh, I wish this incredible futuristic technology. Oh, it's so annoying. So, it'd be nice if it worked, though. Like on Star Trek. Instead, we're living in fucking Brazil. Ugh. The movie.
You know, there's a weird little connection there. I think I told the story here of how it was somebody who worked at Apple that watched how Picard just says, put on some Tchaikovsky or whatever. And he's like, well, Captain Picard doesn't have to put a cartridge in a slot or anything. How could we do that with our computers? And that led to, you know, some of the earliest digitizing codecs, like QuickTime.
Wow.
And, well. Yeah. So Star Trek really did sort of lead the generation. But at the time, Apple was associated closely with Pixar. Mm-hmm. And Pixar at that time was like, you know, nobody. They'd made like one thing. They made like Andre and Wally B or whatever. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to 10 years before that, and how Pixar head Ed Catmull was involved with a project to create what would be the first computer-generated movie. This movie was Tubby the Tuba.
Now,
it turned out, yeah.
You know, you really wouldn't think to watch it. That there's...
You may have noticed that Tubby the Tuba is not computer-generated by any means. It looks like a slightly higher-budget episode of Fat Albert.
Yeah, that's about it. So why did they...
When I first started watching, I was like, this kind of reminds me of Charlotte's Web. And then I was like, oh, I'm sorry, Charlotte's Web. I'm sorry.
Yeah, the vibe is very much like, this is from like, what, 1970-something, I think?
Yeah, this is what movies were kind of like in the 1970s. It's kind of like, oh, if you've ever seen Journey Back to Oz, it's kind of like that one, too.
I haven't seen that, but it does remind me a lot of, if you watch, like, in the 70s and 80s, when they made, like, kind of made-for-TV cartoon movies, like... You know, like Scooby-Doo and the Ghoul School, or like The Good, the Bad, and Huckleberry Hound, where they just feel like they took, they feel like fix-ups, where they just took a bunch of shorter cartoons and mashed them all together.
You really get that from this one.
Yeah. I think Inspector Gadget the movie is probably the worst offender, because it literally is like eight different Inspector Gadget cartoons just played one after the other, without even a framed story.
Like the Heathcliff movie, but that had a frame story.
Yes, exactly like the Heathcliff movie. Not a coincidence, I think, that they're both by Deek. But
remember, Deek stands for Do It Cheap.
Yeah, yes, it does. Now, Tubby the Tuba. So they were going to make this computer animated, but they didn't. Do we know why?
Yes.
Was it?
Well, I mean, for one thing, it was 1975. People barely knew what computers were. How are you going to make an animated movie with computers at that time? But that is why, like, the Institute of Research from New York University or something is credited in this.
It's so,
they were gonna.
That's so weird that they even thought of that. They were like, it's 1975. A computer is, if you want a computer, you basically go to the Pentagon and find, like, you know, one of those warehouses full of vacuum tubes. You know, it's like, we're gonna use the Univac machine to make a cartoon. It's like, why would you even think that? But
I mean, you know, at the time, the biggest video game was Pong, and Pong doesn't even have ROMs. Pong is basically, you know, put together with chewing gum. You can't emulate Pong because there isn't software.
Yeah, so they, I'm trying to look up. Now, apparently, okay, one second. I got to look up the actual first computer animated film. I'm trying to find it because I think it is. Oh, so the actual first ever computer animated film is supposedly from 1974. So Tubby the Tuba is what? It was 1975. Oh, so if it had been computer animated, they would have just missed the boat. Now, the very first one, it's a 1974 animated short film produced by the National Film Board of Canada. So you know it's good.
Of course.
It called Hunger or La Fame, because it's Canadian, so it has to be in both English and French. And if you've seen this, it's very weird. It looks like all just wireframe animation. And if that was a state of computer animation at the time, I mean, it looks like, yeah, if you made Pong into like, I don't think you could watch a long film in this style. But anyway, I guess they didn't. So we'll never see what Tubby the Tuba would have looked like computer animated in 1975.
Well, I think they looked for computer animation because it's ostensibly about inanimate objects. And so the funny thing is, about 10 years later, they basically tried this again, and the people who would go on to be the some of the stars of Pixar were trying to push a CGI movie to Disney, and that movie was The Brave Little Toaster.
Oh. Is that CGI?
Now, The Brave Little Toaster is not CGI, also not CGI. There are some parts that are very nice and smooth, like the shots with the demoniacal electromagnet at the end, but that's about it.
Oh, okay. Well, so Tubby the Tuba, we've talked a lot about what it isn't. So what is it?
Okay. Okay. So Tubby the Tuba ostensibly is like a sort of opera for kids that... It's sort of like how if you take your kids to like a Tiny Tots concert and then they play Peter and the Wolf, it's that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. This is a thing that used to be big, I guess, before we had like, you know,
TV.
cuz I know that, like, you know, growing up, like, yeah, there's a lot of operas for children, and there are people who specialize in making operas for children. And, you know, whenever you watch them, it's like, yeah, this probably was, you know, kids in the 1800s were probably very entertained by this. But I don't live in the 1800s, you know?
I can name two operas for children that stick with me forever.
What are
one they? Is the one they did on one is the one they did on Mr. Rogers,
mm-hmm.
where it was an opera about a cow who didn't want to grow up and give milk. And she had a best friend who was a potato bug who suggests to her that maybe she should grow up to be a potato bug instead.
That's very kids opera. And
that really is. And it had, you know, there's this one shot line in it that just makes me laugh my ass off every time, where the cow is like, oh, I can't wait. I'm going to go tell my mother that I'm going to grow up to be a potato bug. And the potato bug kind of goes like, I better wait here. Don't want to be any part of that.
I remember seeing the opera of Hansel and Gretel, which is fine. It's pretty good. You know, as far as opera versions of Hansel and Gretel go, you know, it's one of those things where you watch it and you're like, yeah, I kind of know what's going to happen. But, you know, yeah.
I mean, I know Hansel and Gretel.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, funny because Hansel and Gretel is one of the few movies, one of the few stories there isn't a Disney version of.
That's true. That's true. But there are at least there are like about 100 Puppetoon versions and about 200 horror reimaginings of it. And there's at least one that involves, what is it, like Hansel and Gretel and a bong, I think, versus Evil Bong or something. I forget. It's been a while.
Oh, is that? Oh. Well, I did read one cool version for young adults that ended with where instead of a gingerbread house, it was like a video game shop, and Hansel was hypnotized into playing all the time, so she ruined his visual diet. And because it was a blind witch who was harvesting people's eyes, and she was training his eyes so she could use them.
That's actually kind of cool.
Yeah.
I like that. That's a very good reimagining. I was about to say, that sounds like something where some cranky old man is like, ah, fucking kids with their video games, I'll show them. But it's actually like a really good reimagining, because I feel like, I mean, kids, I'm sure, still like candy. I mean, that never goes out of fashion. But I feel like also living as we do in, you know, the land of plenty, that saying like, hey, there's a whole house made of candy, isn't that great? Kids would be like, oh, yeah. So, yeah, sure. I could just go to the store and get some. Yeah, whatever. Yeah. You know.
And, of course, let's not forget that Coraline is basically Hansel and Gretel, too.
That is true. That is true. So, Hansel and Gretel, great. A lot of pedigree there.
Yeah.
Now, Tubby the Tuba is, I guess, also an opera for children. And
yeah,
it's from 1945 by Paul Tripp, who is also a... children's opera songwriter. So I guess that's his thing. And I feel like this is an extremely opera for children concept, because I can't think of any other examples to bolster this claim, but I feel like anthropomorphizing the instruments in the orchestra is like a pretty common thing that they do, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what they do with Peter and the Wolf. That's it's introducing you to the concept of leitmotifs.
Yeah, yeah. And that's fine. It's one of those things where if I was a kid, you know, I would, seeing that, I'd be like, yeah, that's fine. I'm not like, you know, it's not a concept that I'm, that excites me, but it's more of a like, well, there is an animated thing on television, so I'll watch it sort of thing. You know, like if they made an opera about dinosaurs, like kids would just like shit their pants when that came on. Or an opera about video games. Now you're cooking with gas, you know, but.
Well, okay. Here's the other one. Once when I was in school, we had this group that comes to put on productions for kids, and it was like this this opera for kids that has the most insane plot ever, where it's about a little girl who it's her birthday, and she gets a belt. She gets a beautiful belt, and she gets chocolate cake, and along the way she asks, "Well, where does chocolate come from?" And they're like, "Oh, I don't know, probably from outer space." And they come to the conclusion that Arapo comes from, chocolate comes from the planet Arapo, where you wear what you eat and you eat what you wear.
And then that
night she dreams that aliens come to her house to steal her belt, to turn it into chocolate.
That is definitely, you know what? That is definitely the most insane plot for a children's opera that I've ever heard.
Yes, and it was all sung too.
So, God, it just, like you said, the concept of a children's opera seems so alien today. You know, it's not, you know, we don't take, it's not, if in, I guess maybe if you live, I don't know, in Manhattan and you're like going to the opera with your little opera glasses, I assume people in Manhattan go to the opera. You have to bring your kids to an opera or something. If you're like one of those eyes wide shut type people, but I mean, normal
they
people.
They won't let you leave them at FAO Schwartz anymore.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, I can't do anything. Thanks a lot, Mitt Romney.
Eric Schwartz. Is that his name?
Yeah, you know, that's why when you go to FAO Schwartz, there's that gigantic Trojan Sabrina skunk in the doorway.
That's right. No, Eric Adams. That was what I was thinking.
Oh, okay. Eric Adams. Yeah, thanks a lot to him, Schwartz. Too. they'll team up. Eric Adams and Eric Schwartz. And I bet Eric Schwartz would make a much better mayor of New York.
I'm sure he would.
He'd be up there being like, all right, my first thing... As mayor, what do you call a thing that mayors do? A commandment? My first commandment as mayor is we're bringing back Amigas. Everyone's going to be using Amigas. Second commandment, more cheese on things. everyone's left foot is now called Eric after me. Eric Schwartz.
Oh, you're the best.
Deep cut. Ask your parents.
Yes.
All right. Anyway, Tubby the Tuba. Paul...
It's hard to focus on Tubby the Tuba because Tubby the Tuba has no real focus.
Oh, my God. So this was, Paul Tripp of Tubby the Tuba fame, I guess, wrote and did he direct this as well?
No, he narrated it.
That's right. So he narrated. I did like in the beginning opening credits, it really... They have like a big fanfare when it says narrated by Paul Kliss, by Paul Tripp.
Yay! Narrated by Peter Criss.
So the Paul Tripp narration, I guess, was like, it felt like it's supposed to be like a big deal, but I was like, I don't know who that is. Maybe he was big in the 70s. And apparently he was, because he did Tubby the Tuba.
He also wrote a book called The Christmas That Almost Wasn't. Not to be confused with The Halloween That Almost Wasn't.
Oh, yeah, The Christmas That Almost Wasn't, but then it was. I remember that from The Simpsons.
Actually, The Christmas That Almost Wasn't, the movie adaptation, appeared on a recent season of Mystery Science Theater.
Oh, that must mean it was very good. All right, so we got Tubby the Tuba. Now, Ethan, when you talked about this last time, you mentioned... Well, I think that it is a It literally is a fix-up. They jammed a second cartoon in the middle of it, or...
It feels like it, doesn't it? Because you watched both versions, right?
Yes.
Because I sent you the link to both the movie and the original Puppetoon short.
Yes.
So,
now,
yeah.
The Puppetoon was in Spanish, but...
I
figured it out. You know, I could figure it out. Like, okay, Tubby the Tuba's sad because all the other instruments make fun of him for sounding like a fart. And then he goes to, and he's sad by a river. And then a frog says, "I love your farty sound, Tubby the Tuba. Why don't you play my music?" And because it sounds like frogs, you know, like tubas. And so he does.
Yeah.
And then he's a big hit. I mean, that's basically it, right?
Yeah, that's pretty much it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And... basically, all of that gets included in the feature film. And then in between there's two totally unrelated stories.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is like the two unrelated stories are okay, you know, as if they were like just their own if they had just done those, they're not really good or anything. But
no.
The problem is this just has this weird feeling where Tubby the Tuba has an adventure and then learns nothing and has no bearing on anything going forward. And then in the last 5 minutes of this movie, of this hour and a half long movie, in the last 5 minutes, this frog appears and solves the problem that has been plaguing him the entire film. So, yeah.
This may be the worst thing we've watched.
It's pretty bad. I don't know if it's the worst thing. I mean, the Control Alt Delete series is pretty bad.
That was pretty bad. Yeah.
But this feels like, well, you know what? This feels like they were people involved who should have known better. So maybe that makes it worse. But we've got Paul.
I would say that this is when you weigh quality against budget. This is the worst movie for your money that we've gotten so far.
Yeah, yeah. So was this a theatrical film?
Yes. Oof. This did get a theatrical release.
God, living in 1975, dire.
Ed Catmull, of Pixar, went on to say about the initial reaction to Tubby. It was awful. It was terrible. Half the audience fell asleep at the screening. We walked out of the room thinking, thank God we didn't have anything to do with it, that our computers were not used for anything in that movie.
You know, and that is saying something, because I feel like audiences in 1975, especially children, would be a lot more forgiving of this sort of garbage, because everything was garbage.
I fell asleep.
Yeah. I definitely had some trouble paying attention because... we do have some star power in this for 1975.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of people who...
should have known better.
Yes. We got Dick Van Dyke as Tubby the Tuba. You all know Dick Van Dyke from the Dick Van Dyke Show and lots of other stuff. He's, you know, even today, I mean, people still know Dick Van Dyke. He's, you know, still active at 97. We have...
Yeah.
David Wayne as Pee-wee the Piccolo.
Do you know David Wayne from something? I had to look him up.
No, I'm looking up right now. But he has been in a lot of stuff, including nothing that I have ever seen. But
apparently, he was the Mad Hatter in the 60s Batman.
Oh, okay. That's good. Well, you know, he's like I said, he's. He was in M, actually, so that's, you know.
That's a...
Yeah.
That is a strong cut.
May see him in another film that we're going to look at someday, because he was in The Sad Sack, based on...
The Sad Sack?
Yeah.
Based on Sad Sack, the comic strip?
Exactly.
Oh, wow.
So we'll probably be seeing this fellow again. We also have Pearl Bailey as Mrs. Elephant.
Pearl Bailey, boy, what a waste of Pearl Bailey, honestly.
Yeah. She's...
And just like a couple years later, she got to be on The Muppet Show, and she blew the roof off.
Well, she is, you know, this is not her, she's basically, she plays Mrs. Elephant, and, you know, that's about it.
Mrs. Elephant.
However, I do want to point out, I think something very interesting about Pearl Bailey is that Pearl Bailey, a Republican, was appointed by President Richard Nixon to be America's very first ambassador of love in 1970. So
what a bizarre choice.
Yeah. So make of that what you will. I don't know. I guess Pearl Bailey got sent overseas to the Nation of Love to, I don't know, represent America. I don't know what duties she had as the ambassador of love. I assume Richard Nixon was just saw her and was like, that's a woman, you know. We get Pearl Bailey, we get Jack Gilford in this as the Herald.
It's a bigger role than you might think from not having a name.
Yeah. The funny thing is, in the beginning, when we have like the credits rolling, they basically have like they show the character and the character says a line that presumably is like their catchphrase or something.
It sort of feels like, well, we can't pay you, but we'll make sure that everyone hears your voice and knows your name.
Yeah. It's just funny because the Herald says something like, can you hear me? Which is like, okay. yeah. And then we get Ray Middleton as the great Pepperino. You'll know him from the Ed Sullivan show.
all you Ed Sullivan fans out there.
Yeah. Yeah. You know.
I don't know. I don't know if there's anything he would have been seen in by the last couple of generations outside of his appearance on MASH.
Yeah, I don't know. There's a lot of, let's just say, there's a lot of working actors in this.
There's a lot of people who were dead more less than 10 years later.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like this, again, this is sort of a thing like older cartoons where they're like, I feel like, when they were always just like, maybe people like, oh, they're always, you know, like nowadays you watch a cartoon and they're like, who are the kids like? Oh, we're going to put Awkwafina in our cartoon, you know, or something. We're going to put Awkwafina and the angry video game nerd and the annoying orange. They're going to voice things in our cartoon. I don't know what the kids are into. I'm just assuming. Whereas in the 70s, they were like, okay, who do I, an old person making a cartoon, think is a big deal? We're going to get someone from like 1920s vaudeville to come, you know, a 100-year-old man to come into our cartoon. So, you know, you got a lot of older names in these old cartoons.
Tubby the Tuba, voiced by Senor Wences.
Yeah. We're gonna get Puppuccino in our cart. Not Puppuccino. Who the fuck was that mouse puppet?
Oh, Topo Gigio.
Topo Gigio. Yeah. Thank you. We're gonna get Topo Gigio. Eddie, the kids will love it. Now we also have. Let's see. We get Jane Powell as Celeste and Cyril Richard as the frog, who does not get a line. Like the frog.
Yeah, he doesn't get a line when they introduce him. They just show him sort of like spinning his bow tie and being like, frog.
Yeah, exactly. we get Ruth Enders as the haughty violin. And I mean, this is a movie called Tubby the Tuba. You can kind of guess what kind of role the haughty violin is going to play in this.
Yes.
And she appears, I think, saying something like, looking like with his little. Holding her glasses down her nose and saying, disgraceful, you know, or something like that. I don't know exactly. She says something like, you know, how dare you? Or a handbag, you know, she talks like that hippo in Rocco's Modern Life.
Yeah. Okay. I went to Ruth Enders, her IMDb page, and it takes you straight to Tubby the Tuba.
Oh, you know, I mean, I'll just say this. I mean, no shade on Ruth Enders, whom apparently only did this. But this is a role that I feel like in the 70s, pretty much every woman, once you hit age 40, this is the role that you play. Like, you know, like an outraged dowager duchess sort of thing, you know? anyway, we also,
it looks like she was also in The Christmas That Almost Wasn't and Mr. I Imagination, which was also created also created by Paul Tripp. So she had some relationship with Tripp.
Okay, that scans. Finally, we also get probably the most baffling character, Miss Squeak, who is played by Hermione Gingold. And and the thing is, she when we get these names, right? Now, Hermione Gingold is an English actress known for her sharp-tongued, eccentric character. She was, you know, in a lot of stuff. But what I think is more interesting is, you know, when we see all these characters, they in the beginning when they're introducing them, we see their name and who plays them, and then after like a brief pause, the picture of the character appears, right? So we got Mrs. Elephant as the first one after Tubby the Tuba, and then we see Miss Squeak, and I was thinking like, oh, clearly a mouse. This is going to be a mouse character, right? And no, she's not a mouse.
I'm not sure what she is. She's like a human instrument hybrid?
Yeah, she looks like... I honestly don't know what she's supposed to look like. She looks like... The only thing I could think of watching her is like if Filmation decided to try to animate Lady Friday puppet from Mr. Rogers.
Yeah, lady, you mean Lady Elaine Fairchild?
That's it. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah.
and the thing is, once we get to her role in the movie, it's I think even more baffling.
It really is.
Yeah.
This whole movie is pretty baffling, honestly.
Yeah. But the thing is, like, there's, like we said, there's basically, there's the main thing with the frog, which was in the puppet tune. And then there's two shorter films inserted into this to pad out the run length to a feature film. And one of them is a very standard Runaway to the Circus story. Exactly what you'd expect, pretty much. And then the second one is absolutely insane. And I guess we'll get to it because I don't think anything we can say before talk. You know what? Let's just get into Tubby the Tuba.
Let's talk about Tubby the Tuba. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's tub it up. We're going to do some tub something.
Yeah, I am gonna get knocked down, and then I'm going to get up again.
We're just a couple of tub girls here talking about Tubby the Tuba.
Okay, so Tubby the Tuba starts with the exact same intro as the short film. We have an orchestra tuning up, and what is weird about this orchestra is that it is all instruments that play other examples of themselves.
Yeah, what is up with that? Because it's an like an anthropomorphic instrument playing a regular instrument.
Yeah, sometimes the regular instrument is part of them, sometimes not. You know, we have this whole row of horns that are just playing horns that look exactly like their own heads. But then we have Tubby, and he just sort of has a sort of coil that he plays, and then music comes out of his own head.
Yes, and just so everyone's clear, now, when you think of an anthropomorphic tuba, I think we all know that the face is going to be on kind of on the side of the bell, and the music will come out of the top of the head, right?
Yes.
Okay, we're all...
And I think... The first time we say anthropomorphic tuba, you imagined a Tyrolean hat, right? Well, you were correct.
Yes. He's got like a little, he's got a little suit on, like a little kind of like a, yeah, Tyrolean hat. He's got a little suit. He looks like he should be like taking a nice little, wander in the Alps.
Yes.
He has a coil he holds in his pocket. He takes it out and plays it sometimes, and it magically makes the music come out of his head. But at least he's actually, you know, he's producing the music in the way out of himself, where every other instrument is just playing an instrument. Like the violins are all just holding violins that they're playing, though they have strings on their bodies, they don't play their own strings.
Oh, well, there's one other, the piccolo, who's his best friend. He really looks phallic, for one thing. And because he has this incredibly long neck with his pinched little head on top. And also, he has all of these valves going up and down his neck, so it looks like he's, you know, had someone take a machine gun to his throat.
Yeah, it's like one of those...
It's really disturbing. There's a little bit of body horror there.
Yeah, it's like one of those cows that they put, like, portholes into. Yeah, but he is... Then we get... I amend my earlier statement. The xylophone does play himself.
Yes, the xylophone plays himself.
The xylophone feels like he should be a bigger character in this, but he really isn't.
Yeah, he really does.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's also that pot-bellied bass drum seems like he should be a more major figure.
Mm, yeah, yeah. I guess the haughty violin is really the only... But besides... I mean, I guess they're all kind of... Just the thing is that they're all dicks to Tubby, because Tubby,
he's chasing the melody, which in this case is like an actual animated musical note, and he's making a huge mess of the entire orchestra somehow, and then he sits on it and it whimpers and dies or something.
Yeah, this whole bit is kind of, it's a little like symbolic. Because obviously they're tossing like this note back and forth to represent that different parts of the orchestra are coming into play. And yeah, when it gets to Tubby, he is, as a tuba, he goes oompa oompa. And so he fucks everything up by sitting on the note and killing the melody, I guess.
I can think of songs that have a melody lit. Led by a tuba, but I suppose they may have come after this.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm sure there are. Apparently, I guess this was all inspired by, or the original 1945 operetta was inspired by Paul Tripp hearing a tuba player complain that tubas, I guess, just don't get to do much, you know?
Yeah.
I guess it was the exact quote is, you know, tubas can sing too. So he decided to make this into a film. Tubby is now sad. Everyone laughs at him, you know, as you do in these sorts of films. The violins get mad at him because he calls them fiddles, which
yes.
I thought was pretty funny. Because my grandmother, God rest her soul, was a concert violinist. And if she ever got called a fiddler, she would fucking lose it. She was, as she liked to say, she was no mere gut plucker.
Meanwhile, my dad has a big bumper sticker on his fiddle case that says, pay the fiddler.
Well, your dad also plays the guitar, doesn't he?
Yeah, guitar, guitarón, a lot of different instruments.
Well, my grandmother would probably have a lot of words about that. She had very little regard for instruments that required actually touching the strings.
Well, he also plays the strovile.
Oh, I don't even know what that is.
Let me get a picture of it for you, because it is, I think it's one of the coolest things he does.
Though I should
see if you can describe it, because I'm not sure if I can.
All right, well, let me take a look here. I should also mention that my grandmother, besides playing the violin, also played the viola. So she really didn't have any, you know, room to talk smack about anything else, considering apparently orchestra people love to make fun of violas people because it's apparently the easiest instrument to play. So they make viola player jokes, like blonde jokes, apparently. So, okay. this thing that you're showing me, this is clearly not a real instrument. This is like a gizmo from a Tim Burton movie. like Johnny Depp would be using this in Sleepy Hollow. It is a violin strings with the what do you call the fiddle neck thing in the middle. It has the strings on it, but the rest of the violin is gone, and instead it's got two Victrola horns, one large, one small, and at the very bottom, what appears to be a bicycle kickstand. So,
That's the chin rest.
Okay, and this is an actual thing that your dad can play?
Yes, it plays just like a violin. The whole point of it is that it's like a violin, but louder. It's from the pre-electric era.
Damn. So. This is very cool, actually. And I did not know that your dad was steampunk.
He's actually pretty steampunk, sometimes diesel punk. Yeah, he has a whole bunch of like old-timey microphones from the 30s that he's gutted and put new stuff in so he can use them on stage.
Damn, that's pretty cool. You know, I would like to see your dad on stage one of these days. I feel like for everything I've heard, he does a good show.
He sure does. But, you know, he's no Tubby the Tuba.
Well, who is Tubby the Tuba these days? Nobody tubs a tuba like Tubby the Tuba. Okay, so nope. Tubby the Tuba, everyone laughs at him, and he leaves the orchestra.
Fat little tuba, fat little tuba, fat little tuba.
Everybody's calling him fat.
He's just kind of normal cartoon character shape.
Yeah.
I think this is an example of how, you know, if they actually made him fat, then kids wouldn't identify with him.
Man, dark, grim. But, but he leaves the orchestra. He's all sad. So his friend, the piccolo, sings a song, I guess, to cheer him up and to pad out the running time. Things, because you know how it is, Ethan, things might be bad. Things might be better. Things might be bad. Things might be worse. And it's like, yeah, you've really covered your bases. That is all the things that things can be. So,
wait, I forgot to list all the things that things can be. Things might be unbetter. Things might be less than worse than, but better than that. No, better than you're thinking.
Yeah, this song really goes on and on. But that is.
Yeah. So. It makes sense that Tubby completely writes it off.
I would. I mean, actually, this is, again, the state of music in children's cartoons and film. I think pre-Little Mermaid, they all kind of sucked. I mean, the best you could hope.
Once in a while, you gotta, where there's a whip, there's a way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I think the best you could hope for is, like, you might get a little bit of, like, maybe there'll be a jazz number. But, like, you know, it's funny that, like, until, 1989, you would not hear, like, rock music in a cartoon, which is very weird.
Well, that would get all the mothers sounding like Mrs. Fiddle.
Oh, yeah, exactly. How dare you! So, I guess this is kind of operatic music, maybe, but whatever. Anyway, the point is, Tubby sees a circus come to town, and a little tiny version of Tubby comes out of his head. I guess this is his conscience or whatever.
It seems to be a physical presence. There are times when he uses his smaller self as, like, a tool.
Oh, that's
he,
right.
Like, opens a door with it.
Yeah.
At the end, his better self or whatever is gathered with the others clapping for him. So it's like, so he just has like a remote version of himself, like that comic where Superman gained the ability to shoot smaller Superman out of his fingers.
Tubby the Tuba, he's full of tinier men. It is, I mean, it's one of those things where they intended this to be like his inner monologue, but they didn't think it through very much, so it doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
This movie feels like an exquisite corpus.
Mm.
Like they had, like, they didn't know what the next person in line, what the last person had done, and they were just sort of, you know, filling in what they thought was happening.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's funny because they have Tubby the Tuba. It's like, clearly he needs a friend to, like, talk to convince him to do stuff, but they didn't give him one, so he's got this inner monologue instead. Because the Piccolo character is kind of a non-entity. He's just, you know,
He should come with him, honestly, but then there's the scene later where the Piccolo gets fed up with him. And I guess you can't do that with your inner monologue, but it's not his conscience because the little Tubby keeps leading him to bad ideas.
Yeah, I guess it's just supposed to be, I mean, I guess it's just him. Yeah, I guess it's, It's, I guess it's basically the
what
little,
is it?
It's the little devil, shoulder devil, I guess. You know?
Yeah, but he doesn't have an angel.
Yeah, so that, you know, so I guess they were like, look, just make it a little Tubby, because otherwise this isn't gonna, it's not gonna fly. But yeah, he convinces Tubby to join the circus because he's like, you could be anything in the circus. You could be a tightrope walker. You could be an acrobat. You could be a clown. You don't have to be a tuba. You can be anything, you know? Which is like, okay.
Which is, now, doesn't the circus have a band?
Yes. I would assume that they have a band. You know, they have to do that, you know, whenever they come out.
Shouldn't he be, you know, shouldn't he have some moment when he talks to the steam calliope?
You know that.
And the calliope is like, you know, calliope, don't you get tired of going, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do?
You know, it'd be funny. The calliope is probably just a guy. It's a anthropomorphic calliope turning the crank on a regular calliope. But yeah, we don't meet the calliope, which is kind of a, it's kind of a wasted opportunity because you could do a lot with that. But knowing this movie, they probably wouldn't. It's basically, this is the bit where, you know how all kids movies, basically they either, they're only two themes for kid, two lessons in kids movies. One is you can be anything if you put your mind to it. The other one is be yourself. And this movie seems like it's gonna go the whole you can be anything, but then later on it decides no, just be yourself. So but anyway, Tubby the Tuba, he joins a circus and they say, oh, you're an anthropomorphic tuba, well, you know what you'll be really good at, giving water to the elephants. So that's what he does. He's the elephant slopper. And
so just like in the movie, water for elephants.
Yeah. And he's giving them water. And then they say, all right, we've had enough water. We're satisfied with the amount of water we had. Mrs. Elephant says this, played by Pearl Bailey. Yes. And she's like, since I am now satisfied with the amount of water that I have consumed, you should go watch the circus in action because you've earned that. And he does that, but he accidentally falls into the circus ring and fucks up the whole circus, you know?
Yeah. He somehow wanders onto the tightrope and this is, it doesn't make, he doesn't somehow wander. His, the mini Tubby, leads him up there.
Oh yeah. It's all like, and oh, it's fun.
And so he causes a huge accident and gets fired. And, to cheer him up, Mrs. Elephant, who, oh my God, some of these shots of her are just so hideous. My God. Mrs. Elephant says, well, what's so bad about your oompa? Let's hear it. And the elephants love his oompa, and they start dancing. And that gets Mrs. Elephant to go grab Signor Pepperoncini and show him, like, hey, look what's going on. And now it turns out that Tubby has this sort of Pied Piper ability with the elephants.
This scene is great because, it's basically Tubby is doing his oompa, and these elephants are doing basically the elephant walk thing where they all hold each other's tails in their trunks, and they walk in this endless circle in the moonlight. And so when the ringmaster appears and he's like, I've never seen anything like this. It's so beautiful. It feels like he's witnessing some sort of arcane ritual that he walked into a forest clearing and some Diana and her nymphs are walking around or something in this circle. It feels a lot more portentous than it really is in this bit.
Yeah, it's like, they're going to lead me to the secret elephant burial ground.
Yeah.
Finally.
Oh, by the way, yeah, this picture of Mrs. Elephant is pretty great, though, because I guess they were like, oh, well, obviously an elephant has two eyes, right? So make sure that we can see both eyes no matter what angle this elephant is at. You know, like a Picasso.
Yeah, she looks like she's protruding one eye like a conch out of its shell.
Oh my God, real Popeye hours here, you know? So she is, Mrs. Elephant also, she's got one of those little bonnets. She looks like Dumbo's mom, basically.
Yeah. Otherwise, these elephants are very basic cartoon elephants. They look, you know, more or less Well, they have very small heads for elephants, so they look, you know, more human shaped for the most part.
Yeah.
And see, the thing is, these elephants all talk, so, and they are able to argue, argue with Pepperoncini about the contract. So it's just like, you know, what's so amazing about seeing dancers dance if they're just people who happen to have trunks?
That's true, but it's a real big deal. So Tubby the Tuba is offered a contract to come back to the circus, but he also, as a shrewd negotiator, asks that the elephants get all the peanuts they could eat, which I guess previously they didn't get, but I don't know. Now Tubby is a big deal, and they have that montage of, like, you know, the circus going around, and now Tubby is like, you know, he's, the fame is going to his head and he's forgetting the little people, and he's like doing that thing where, you know, when you get rich and famous in a cartoon and you just turn in, you suddenly start speaking with a very affected British upper class voice, you know?
Yeah, that's all very well and good, Mater.
Exactly, you know, and he's carrying around, like, what, this what has he got, like a scepter or something now?
I guess it's a diamond topped cane.
But you know, it's funny because everyone.
My favorite shot is where his friend the Piccolo is showing the showing Tubby on the front of the newspaper to the other instruments, and he's like, "Bet you're sorry you called him a fat little tuba now, right?" And they all just sort of give this long sneer, just kind of bear forward and go,
"Egh." I mean, honestly, that's the way I would react, you know, if someone said, if I made fun of someone and that person went on to, like, fame and fortune, and then someone showed me that person's picture in the newspaper and said, "Hey, don't you feel bad?" I would say no, and I would treat that person who tried to make me feel bad with utter contempt, because I am extremely petty, just like an instrument in an orchestra. So yeah, this was very relatable when they reacted like that. You know, the Piccolo, like, I think Tubby comes back to town with the circus, and he drives around in his chauffeured limo. He picks up the Piccolo, and, you know, he's being a real, like, bore and talking about how great he is, you know.
The little Tubby is encouraging this. It's like, you know, blow off this jerk. You don't need him anymore.
Yeah. The Piccolo is kind of like, I wouldn't hang out with this Piccolo. He's kind of annoying, to be honest. You know, what's he actually bringing to the table here? I mean, I guess he does that song. I guess he, like, oh, remember that one really annoying song where he said that, like, hey, things, peoples is peoples, you know? It's like, oh, thanks a lot, PB the Piccolo. Not very helpful. But then it's funny because, what's his name? Tubby is all like, I gotta go do my thing. I have to rehearse my great new act.
This is great.
Yeah, and then he's like, here's a free ticket for the show. And Tubby walks away, and, you know, after he walks away, Piccolo, like, tears up the ticket and walks and, like, to the ticket stand and just buys another ticket.
Why did you do that?
Yeah, it's like, oh, I guess he's like, oh, I'm mad at Tubby for being kind of a show off, so I refuse to accept his charity. I'm just gonna buy my own ticket. But it's like, why even go to the fucking show, you know?
Yeah, honestly,
it's like,
why is Tubby the star of this when it's the elephants that are performing?
That is a very good question. He literally is just he's like, I'm the most famous tuba in the world because I do that oompa. It's like, you mean like every tuba? Like, literally, you have shown that, like, you're not nothing special. Every tuba does this. You just happen to be the first one that that Pepperoncini has ever met, apparently, and he doesn't realize that's a tuba thing, you know.
Yeah. But are you the only tuba in the world? Were you, like, sent here from the planet Tubetron or something?
You know, that's where they eat clothes and wear chocolates. It's funny because then he's like, I'm going to go get ready for my big new act tonight. And Pepperoncini is all like, I need to talk to you, Tubby. And he and Mrs. Elephant are all like, don't do the act. It's too dangerous. And it's like, okay, look, he's scheduled to do the act tonight. Maybe you should have brought this up a little earlier, you know?
Yeah. Maybe they only just found out what it was. I don't know.
Yeah. But... and it's like, he's, and Tubby is all like, if you don't, I'll do the act without you if you don't want to. But it's like, when we see what the act is, like, once again, the elephants are the act, not Tubby.
Yeah.
Because it is.
Once again, Tubby cannot stay off that fucking high wire.
Yeah. This time, Tubby and all the elephants are on the high wire above a lion cage full of lions and tigers who have not been fed in 3 days. And
why haven't they fed the lions and tigers? I guess an elephant hasn't died recently.
Well, that changes soon. No, I don't think any elephants die in this act, but, well, actually, what does happen? He falls, right? He fucks it up, like, or something.
Yeah, he falls, and he falls into the lion and tiger cage, and I guess they're hungry for tuba?
Oh, that's right.
Is he still made of brass?
That's right, because they bite a big hole in his pants as he's trying to escape, and the audience immediately just goes into hysterics at the sight of Tubby's underwear that says Oompa on it. And yeah, it's like, you know, Tubby...
of all the days to wear the underwear with the little rocket ships.
I think it's funny that, like, in this audience is so incredibly fickle. It's like, Tubby is not out of danger. He is literally being mauled to death by, like, wild animals. But they see his ass and they're just, like, losing it. Like, it's so funny that this guy who's dying... you know, we saw his underwear. And...
I could see his two butt.
Eventually Tubby gets out, but like the ringmaster's all like, you're fired because I don't know. I feel like this would actually be more entertaining to people to see. It would actually get people, yeah, you know, like failing in a high wire act is actually, you know, just as entertaining as succeeding. So I don't know why Tubby is fired. But they decide
it's like flaming death.
Yeah, exactly. Then they make Mrs. Elephant the new star, which I don't know why she wasn't already, because she was the one doing all the work. But
yeah, I mean, we never saw anyone else perform except when they were doing the parade.
Yeah. So this is the end of the circus arc, I think. Do we miss anything else?
And after this, the circus is not mentioned again.
Nope. Piccolo is basically like, hey, Tubby, why don't you come back to the orchestra? We're going, because he had mentioned while they were in the car, hey, tomorrow, you know, the whole orchestra, we're going to go to Singin' City. We're going to the Singin' City to get we're all going to get melodies. You should come with us, Tubby. And now that Tubby's been fired from the circus, he's like, all right, I'll do that.
Why didn't we do that in the first place? Why didn't anyone tell me that was where you go to get a melody?
I mean, that is a very good question. And in fact, there's a lot of good questions that come up once we get to the Singing City.
Also, I like that the Piccolo is, you know, has completely forgiven Tubby for being such a dick to him earlier.
Oh, yeah. That really didn't go anywhere at all, that plot line.
No.
It's just immediately forgiven because we got to get to Singin' City. We got a new thing that we're talking about now. We got a whole new bag. And it's this.
Now I'm into this cup and ball.
Yeah. they get in the bus. There's the bus, right? To go to Singin' City.
Yes.
And the other instruments kind of, again, make fun of Tubby. I can't know. I don't remember if they're making fun of him because they're like, oh, look. Oh, I think they're all like, you know, oh, look, the most famous tube in the world coming to, you know, that.
Slum it up with us, piece of shit instruments.
Yeah, that sort of thing. But then also riding on the bus is Prince Cello, who.
Yeah.
Who
was he part of the orchestra before? We didn't see him.
No, we have not seen this guy before. He's not introduced as Prince Cello at this point. He's just a guy that looks, he's not like, because most of the instruments are vaguely instrument-like. This looks like, he's an anime guy, like a Bishonen anime guy who's wearing a cello cosplay, is kind of what it is.
Yes.
And he just is, he kind
of... he looks like Kevin McDonald wearing the body of a guitar for underwear.
Yes, exactly. He gets on the bus and he's all like, welcome back, Tubby. everyone be quiet. Don't be mean to Tubby. And it's just like, who's this guy? Well, later on, we find out that this guy's a prince. A prince of the orchestra. Possibly the prince of instruments. I don't know the politics of instruments are not really clearly explained in this. So, you know.
So, yeah. So, okay, Singing City. So they take this dirt road out of town to a city, which I guess is with giant harps for gates. So it's a gated community. And there's a giant castle there, too. I guess that's where the prince lives.
Yeah, it gets very Phantom Tollbooth-y, you know?
Yeah, it does not feel like they're in the same world now. I mean, like, okay, how many sapient races have we met so far? There are instruments, there are humans, there are animals, and now with the prince, there are instrument-human hybrids.
Yes.
And then we are introduced to a new race, which is melodies. Apparently they're people.
Yeah, they're kind of, I think they're people. The way they're drawn, they have basically kind of, they have disembodied kind of big round heads like Canadians in South Park. And I think
they're kind of Rayman-ish.
Yeah. I think they're supposed to like recall musical notes a little bit or bring those to mind, but
yeah,
they aren't quite musical notes. They live in this city and, the city where if cars crash into each other, they turn into a big accordion for a moment before turning back into cars. And yeah. I think there's a song about the singing city. And then all the instruments come into the city and the herald, who we mentioned earlier, introduces them all. And it turns out, "Can you hear me?" actually is his catchphrase, because he always does this, hear ye, can you hear me? Which they think is very funny, because they do it like 3 or 4 times. So all the instruments come in one by one, and he announces them. And Tubby is already in the city, so he's clapping for them all as they come in. But at the very end, he walks out the front gate and tries to come back in, and the herald kind of like, "Hey, who the fuck are you?" And he's like, "I'm Tubby the Tuba." And the herald's like, "It's Tubby the Tuba." Which
which is probably the funniest line.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of amusing. They also, they say lastly, the xylophone right before Tubby comes in. So again, it feels like he should be something, but
Tubby, you missed your cue.
Yeah, so anyway, xylophone's there. He doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
But
the humans who live in this world are all very Flintstones looking.
Yes. Now, So what happens next? This is very,
it feels like they swapped in another script.
Yeah, and it is, okay. So there's a big, it's a little kind of Cinderella type stuff now, because the Prince Cello, who I guess lives in the castle in Singing City. It seems like he runs the castle, but he was with the orchestra in the real world, so I guess he had taken a break to go concertize
you assumed this is now the real world.
Well, yeah, you know, I'm doing the thing like when in that shitty Oz adaptation where they're like, "Oh, Oz in the real world," you know.
Yeah.
I can't remember which Oz one that was actually. Anyway,
I don't know either, but I know that in the Mario Saturday morning cartoons, they referred to the Mushroom Kingdom, and then there was the real world.
Oh, okay. So yeah, that sort of thing, you know, it's basically, yeah. I mean, it's not even a different world. We haven't gone through like a portal or anything. It's literally just the city where anthropomorphic melodies live. So it seems to be that Prince Cello, he's having a big old ball, which includes a contest wherein melodies will compete. And I'm not sure if every instrument gets paired off with a melody, or they're looking for one melody for the whole orchestra. but it's also the fact that the melodies in this, they're from the orphanage, right? The melody orphanage. So
yeah.
So they're all kind of portrayed as children, and this feels uncomfortably like they're auctioning off child brides.
It really does. Yeah, I mean, you if you want to be really generous, it could kind of comes across as like a cotillion or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, I don't know, like, yeah, it's when a bunch of instruments wearing, like, you know, tuxedos, drinking wine, and they have these children come in and perform for them so they can choose the best. It feels very like, is this Epstein's Island or something? Because I don't know what's happening. But on his way to the big ball, Tubby passed by the orphanage and he saw that there's one orphan Melody that does not look like a child. She looks like a full grown woman with a bosom and everything. Or I guess more that she's got like a little wasp waist. So I guess that implies bosom.
But she has hips, I guess.
Yeah.
It means she's submissive and breedable.
Ah, there we go. Tubby is a return tuba, you know. He's a trad tuba. But she is also in the orphanage, which is run by the terrible Mrs. Squeak, or Miss Squeak, who...
Yeah, she looks like she might be part violin, but she's mostly human.
Yeah, and some cop, like a Melody cop, explains to Tubby, like, oh yeah, that's Celeste up there, and that's the terrible Mrs. Squeak who runs the orphanage. It's like, okay, so we all know that the orphanage is run by, like, an evil woman? Okay.
Yeah.
And Mrs. Squeak doesn't like Celeste and decides to lock her in the closet and not bring her to the ball.
But then you're going to be stuck with her.
Yeah.
I thought you didn't like her.
It's not really explained why this happens. I guess
she's just mean to her for no reason.
Yeah. It's like, and it's funny because at the ball, Tubby's all like, hey, where's Celeste? And she's like, she's locked in a closet back home. It's like, oh,
where she belongs. Yeah,
it's like, okay. It's so weird. But also, is a celeste an instrument? I've never heard of a celeste.
The celesta is an instrument. I know, or maybe it's celesta. I'm not sure. You know the dance of the sugar plum fairy, right? That's traditionally played on the celesta.
Oh, okay. Because when she's first introduced and the guys and the cop says that her name is Celeste, Tubby's like, oh, like the instrument. I've never heard of it, but I'm not like,
it's a very small keyboard instrument that sort of resembles a toy piano and makes its music is it's actually a percussion instrument because it strikes little metal blocks to play music.
So Tubby is smitten with Celeste, and while the ball is going on, he runs off to save Celeste and get her out of the closet. His little head guy helps him out with that.
Yeah. Yeah, the little head guy. Yeah, what does he do?
He tells Tubby to use his head.
That's right.
And Tubby first tries to batter down with his head, but then thinks of better. He uses his tuba powers and, like, blows it down with the force of his...
Yeah, he launches his little self at it, like a human cannonball.
Yes.
So it is a physical thing. Can other people see it?
It's...
Do other people have these?
You know, yeah, nobody ever... Yeah, it's his daemon, like in, his Dark Materials. But, that's a Celeste?
Yeah.
Oh, it looks like a Hammond like organ.
Little bit of piano.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
All right. This is what Celeste is named after, this weird little piano that kind of looks like a grill. But Tubby is smitten with her. Meanwhile, so here's the weird thing, okay? Back at the ball, the different melodies are performing, like, for the you know, I guess to try and win this contest, right?
Yes.
And we get like
one does, you know, one does the polka, you know, one does, you know, one does a waltz. My favorite is the one who has the dirge.
Yeah. I want to know about what's her deal, because there's this one kind, like all they all kind of dance and prance, and then there's this one blue-haired melody who kind of just like slogs across the floor looking all like mopey and sad, and they play a dirge and everybody just starts yawning. And I
don't think the point of a dirge is to be sleepy.
Is it?
No, is it? I mean, are you supposed to fall asleep during a funeral?
Yeah, I didn't think that was really what it was for, but like I was kind of thinking like, oh, the way they portray it, like everyone's kind of like being mean to that one. I thought she was going to, you know, like, you know how it is, like kind of like be a foil for Tubby in a way, or not a foil, but you know, because it's like she should be his
match.
Yeah,
she should be the one that everyone laughs at. Yeah,
exactly.
Like, well, I could play a beautiful song if it was slow and sad, if it were a dirge. That's what tubas can do.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I felt like watching this, it was like, that is the natural thing to happen here. It's like, look, he's looking for his melody. That is the melody that fits him. And, you know, she's experiencing the same pain that Tubby is feeling. So why is she not the focus? But she just kind of, you know, she's just this incidental character who doesn't get any, you know, doesn't. I don't know. I felt like she should have been a bigger thing. But
yeah, I mean, I immediately saw her as like, hey, that one's different. I want to learn more about her.
Yeah, it was like, I want to know more about this little goth melody, you know, but yeah. she doesn't. Yeah, the movie immediately forgets about her because Tubby brings Celeste back. And okay, so then Celeste basically, like, she wows them all, and Prince Cello comes towards her, and she goes towards Prince Cello, and Tubby, seeing that they are going to embrace, you know, and do that thing, that princess prince thing, you know, he immediately mm-hmm. rushes between them and cock blocks Prince Cello and is all like, this is mine. I want to claim.
Dibs.
Yeah, I claim this melody as mine. She belongs to me. I own her.
Yeah, he should have licked his finger and touched her.
Yeah. And Prince Cello, being a man of honor, you know, he recognizes dibs. So he steps back. But Tubby then, like, he tries to dance with Celeste, but he's a farty tuba, so it doesn't really work very well. So he kind of does that thing where he's like, he realizes that, you know, Celeste and Prince Cello are better matched. So he kind of steps back and lets Prince Cello have her. And he does a thing where he walks away like all sad. And I guess we're supposed to be like, oh, Tubby, you're the bravest man I've ever known because you did this. But it's like, oh, Tubby, you didn't force yourself on a woman. So we all have to give you an applause.
Our hero.
It's like our hero. Instead, you let instead you're like, Prince Cello, you can own this woman. She can be your property. She can be your chattel slave. So, yeah, whatever. I don't know. I guess she's into Prince Cello, so it's okay. But I don't know. This whole segment of the movie is so incredibly weird. I can't get over how child bride-y it all feels.
It keeps changing the rules on you over and over.
Yeah, it's like I thought the way they introduced it, it sounded like everyone was going to go to get a melody of their own, you know, which again makes it sound like we're a Boy Scout troop and our scoutmaster's taking us to a brothel, you know, that's what it sounds like.
We're the boys from Camp Cucamonga. Yeah.
Mother sent us here to teach these nature's ways. Learn to make sparks by rubbing sticks together. But classic.
If we catch a melody, we'll set the what's a blues.
But then it turns out, I guess they're not each getting a melody. There's, I think it's no wait.
They're just picking one, yeah.
The melodies do stand next to instruments, but it's not really clear to me if that means that they each have picked one, or they just are standing there now. You know, it's not really. But I mean, that wouldn't make sense anyway, because the whole orchestra has to play the same melody, or else it's, you know, not it's madness. Yeah.
So Tubby just doesn't even wait for the bus. He walks all the way home from Singing City.
Oh, yeah. We're done with Singing City now. Who cares about that? We're done. Never going to mention it again. Prince Cello, out of the picture. He's, you know, now we're...
We don't see what happens to the melodies. This is like, okay, now we are returning to the rest of the story as laid down by the original puppetoon.
Yes. So Tubby is hanging out by a lake, being sad. A frog, a bullfrog appears, and it's basically all like, it's doing that. This is a frog. It's like, oh, it's, you know, it talks like Peter Ustinov, and it's all like, you know, it's got like, what is it? It's got like a song that it wants Tubby to play because he's, you know, he sounds like a frog. So when he plays it, he can play frog songs. And the frog is like, take it back to your orchestra, play this song.
Yeah.
And Tubby does.
I've never heard a tuba go brekkekex kalax coax. But
as we know, the frogs actually say "Edelus, horseman." I guess Tubby just takes it back to the orchestra. He doesn't actually give the stuff the conductor. He just starts playing it in the middle of whatever piece they're playing. And
yeah, and they have a special guest conductor too.
Yeah, it's you might know him. It's Wit from Wit's End of Oracles and Odyssey. Sorry, Adventures and Odyssey. Yeah, I don't know. They say his name, but I don't remember what it is. It's like Rigatoni or
Leopold.
Something.
Leopold.
That's what?
Leopold. Nah.
But yeah, they but he's intrigued. He's intrigued by Tubby's performance. So he you know, he says, "I want to hear more." So Tubby plays more. And I guess that's when he realized that tubas can also sing. And I guess that's the end of Tubby the Tuba.
Yeah. And so he generates one of those melodies that everyone catches and throws back and forth. So this has all been like a big game of keep away or something.
Yeah.
And he finally got the keep away. Hey, oh, I just noticed that, you know, you don't see much of him, but the prince is playing in the orchestra too.
Oh, is he? Okay. So I guess the prince is back. It's funny that
he also seems to be playing himself, unlike the rest of them.
You know, I do think it's very funny that the cello is like the prince, because I feel like if you had royalty in the orchestra, it should be the conductor's baton or something, you know?
Yeah, the baton is not a person for some reason.
The puppetoon version of the baton is a person, though. The baton is like a little he's a stick that yells. He's kind of like you know,
like a real baton.
Yeah, yeah. That is, so that was the Thanksgiving story of Tubby the Tuba.
Yes. And what a Thanksgiving story it was. Why, I feel like I've been planting corn with Squanto already.
It's the greatest Thanksgiving story ever told. Yeah. Yeah. I feel like a regular Miles Standish after, seeing that.
Vile Standish.
But you can see why I believe modern audiences would not gel with Tubby the Tuba.
And contemporary audiences did not either.
No. Again, this is a fix up. It's just three unrelated things happening, and not particularly interesting unrelated things.
No, I sort of feel like they were like, okay, we'll have three stories in here. And if you cut one out, then you can run it as a 1 hour special. And if you cut them both out, then you can run it as a 7 minute cartoon.
That's true. I mean, they did make it in such a way that you could cut things out without losing anything. You know, it's feels like that's by design. So, it is.
Yes, it's like how sometimes you would see theatrical movies that have a fade out for the commercial built right in the theater. That's always weird.
Yeah, man. Yes, this is. I guess they had high expectations for Tubby the Tuba. Mark Tripp really thought they had something here. But
honestly, Tubby the Tuba comes across as the kind of story that a local author has printed through a vanity press.
It's a very Ernie Hergen Higenberger.
Yes, Ernie Hergenroder. Yeah, exactly.
that's unfair, I think, because he's actually a local artist, not a writer. Yeah. So He just
draws what he's paid to. Yeah. He doesn't write the stories.
I shouldn't blame him for Value Mountain, the treasure of Value Mountain, or whatever it is. You're correct. This is very much a local author makes good type story. Because if you know anything about local authors, besides the one thing that they love to do, besides writing terrible stories and publishing through vanity presses, they love anthropomorphizing random shit, you know? Like,
yes. Like almond blossoms or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. And it's a funny thing because I remember reading like one of those, like every so often you can read like in Writer's Market or Guide or something, and they'll interview agents and be all like, okay, this is what we want, right? And I remember one agent was like, look, please stop anthropomorphizing everything. It's a hard enough sell getting, you know, anthropomorphic animals out there. You don't need like anthropomorphic like trash cans and, you know, bed frames and light bulbs and, you know, in my local bookshop, there are a lot of children's books written by local authors. And I always remember one of them, Barfy the Barf Bag. That is an actual book written by a local author here in my town, illustrated by the guy, our own Ernie Higgin Hergen Bottom of this town, whose name I can't remember at all, because I'm an idiot. And I dragged out Ernie Hergy Higginbottom's name as far as possible to give myself time to Google it to see if I could find the name, but I didn't. So, anyway.
Now you say that, but then you go to Target and it's full of books like The Bad Seed, The Smart Cookie, The Cool Bean, The Great Egg Scape, The Big Cheese, The Sour Grape.
I guess actual authors do this sort of shit as well.
Yes. But they can actually afford good artists.
Yeah. I guess like a lot of these kind of, you know, a lot of these children's books that aren't particularly good can lean on the strength of the art.
Mm-hmm.
But
it was like, this is a, you know, we got to have this book up at the front because it's a not Newbery Award winner, the Caldecott Award winner. And it's like, well, that just means it has nice illustrations. The book itself is it's called Hitler Did Nothing Wrong.
Ooh, problematic.
Yeah, but it was a Caldecott in Germany.
Well, you know. Well, Caldecott.
In 1944.
Caldecott. Wow. Well, the mark of quality. Because, you know, if Make Way from Ducklings gets it, so.
Make Way for Ducklings. Let's see. Oh, man. How many of these have I even seen? Oh, Blueberries for Sal? Really? Of course. Well, the problem with these is that a lot of them were published in black and white, so they don't look as good now.
I mean,
oh man, McElligot's Pool was nominated but didn't win. Boo.
I mean, I feel like the Caldecott Award is like, wait, am I thinking of the Caldecott Award? Let me look at this. I got to look at this. It's one of the, it's if you're a kid, Caldecott is fine. That's for the little kids' books, right?
Yeah,
I'll tell you what the mark of...
Are you thinking of the Newbery?
Yeah, that's the mark of death. Like, you see the Newbery Award on the front of a book, and it's just like, oh, God, this is going to be a slog. This is going to be...
Hey, if...
It's like, you know, when you see that Newbery Award, it's like, oh, it's probably a book about, like, you know, like a 10-year-old kid dying of cancer in a post-irradiated, like, hellscape after nuclear war and, you know, yeah. getting
raped. Or else it's Maniac McGee.
Oh, my God. Maniac McGee, what a ripoff. What a ripoff that one is. I'm sorry. You read that and it's like, oh, this is based on a true story, right? Otherwise, no, it's not. It's just all made up. But it's like, oh, but he's going to city where, like, white people and black people are, like, not allowed to mix. And it's like, when does this book take place? Isn't this contemporary? This is, like, what, the 90s or something. But they still have, what, sundown cities? What is this?
In the 90s, they might have. I don't know.
I mean, I'll admit, I was living overseas in the 90s, so I don't know what America was like. I was in
1991. I might not bet against it.
Oh my God. I guess maybe 1991, like, you know, Americans would pick up Maniac McGee and be like, wait a minute, black people and white people, why? They should just, we should all get along. Thank you, Maniac McGee. You're the wisest man I've ever known. Thank you for showing us the error of our ways here in racist America. Though, you know what? I make fun, but considering how much we've backslid on these issues, maybe we need Maniac McGee to come back.
Yeah.
We need the Maniac McGee movie right now. Make the Maniac McGee movie.
They say Maniac McGee was born in a junkyard. They say his stomach was a cereal box and his heart was a sofa spring. I don't know why they say that. That sounds pretty patently made up.
Do they say that in the book?
No. But, well, the first couple parts, yeah.
Because I was going to say, like, that sounds like a much better book than you actually get. Because it feels like, oh, I'm going to get, like, a fucking junk punk robot boy? Nope. He's just regular. He just runs fast. Okay.
Yeah.
I guess he runs fast. He runs like a maniac. Oh, I get it. Is that why they call him Maniac McGee? Yeah. They also call him that because his last name is McGee. Ergo, the full name, Maniac McGee. Okay, got it.
Just like the show Maniac McGee and Me.
Oh yeah, I remember that show. We used to watch that in that Bible camp where we had the killer monkey.
Maniac Bible Camp.
Maniac Bible Camp. That sounds like the new.
Oh man, now that's a great horror movie.
You know what? Right, Maniac Bible Camp. That's the next big thing. I like. It sounds like an Erdorf game. Oh, Maniac Bible Camp. Okay, you know what? We're gonna patent this. Maniac Bible Camp. Nobody else do this.
Maybe that should be the game that we do.
Oh, there you go. Okay. We put a pin in that. Remember Maniac Bible Camp.
Maniac Bible Camp.
But Tubby the Tuba, we got a little off Tubby course on Maniac McGee.
Did, yeah.
Well, have we learned any? We learned a lot from Maniac McGee, but do we learn anything from Tubby the Tuba?
I mean, learn a lesson from Ed Catmull and know when to pull out and how to recognize that somebody can't actually bring a movie to completion.
That wise words. In fact, you might say that he made out like a bandit.
He sure did.
So, he was able to, because of that, Pixar did not suffer any setbacks because of this film, and they went on to make Tin Toy, and, they made other movies too. I can't remember the names right now. The Good Dinosaur. Y'all love that.
Yeah, that's the Good Dinosaur is where everyone started to get a little tired of this whole Pixar thing.
Yeah, I don't think anyone actually saw that one, which is kind of ironic coming from me.
I did.
Oh, you did? How was it?
I mean, it was okay, but I felt like it was... I felt like they did not really explore the concept that they set forward. That's like, okay, so it's about a world where dinosaurs have been around for 65 million years, and now they're basically... You know, they're basically quadrupedal humans because they never went extinct. It's like, okay. And then they're just, you know, they just walk around in the wild and eat leaves. It's like, you know, did this need to take place 65 million years later just so you could have a human?
Oh, yeah, that's weird. They should have just been like, they're dinosaurs. There's a human here, too, because we're doing Flintstone logic.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like some nerd at Pixar, they were going to do that, and some nerd was like, actually, humans did not live at the same time as dinosaurs. And so Ed Catmullen was all like, oh, God, fine. 65 million years later. Happy? There you go.
And that man was John Lasseter.
That's why he got kicked out of Pixar. Also being a sex pest, I think. That was him, right?
Yeah, that was him. Okay. Yeah. They say that, you know, all the women at Pixar got used to sort of tying themselves into knots to protect anything that he might put a hand on. Very disappointing. Very disappointing. I saw him at what do you call it? San Diego Comic-Con. I saw him give a talk with Hayao Miyazaki, his friend.
Oh.
And yeah, it's kind of, and you know, Miyazaki, I'm sure, must be tremendously disappointed in him too.
Yeah. Miyazaki, I didn't imagine seeing that like thing, and Joe Lasseter is all like, yeah, you know, the Daves, you got blah, blah, boom. You love them skirts. And Miyazaki's like, you know what's really great? Slime people. We need more of those. Yeah, I really like when they're gooey. Oh, yeah. He loves gooey. He loves the goo. But, you know.
Oh, yes. That's going to be in the new movie. I'm really looking forward to The Boy and the Heron.
I'm being really, like, churlish about Miyazaki. The greatest, the greatest filmmaker of Japan's favorite son. The man who, like, revolutionized animation as a storytelling medium, you know.
And your one joke about him is that he's into slime.
He's into slime. I mean, no shade, you know. It's like we're all into something. Who is the guy who made like Iron Boy, you know, Astro Boy?
Oh, Osamu Tezuka? Yeah, he legit hentai furry art.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty...
And he wasn't even really hiding it.
No, I mean, it's like, you know what? Hey, let your freak flag fly, you know? So good on him. I mean, I think it's great when, like... Because I've said it before, when you are, you know, an artist of any medium, you have that superpower. That superpower is making what makes you horny real. So good on him.
The thing about that talk that I saw them give was that they had a whole bunch of people lined up to ask questions, and like one of the last questions was somebody who asked Miyazaki, sir, why do you have so many girls in your work?
What?
And yeah, and there was this sort of like pause, like is he serious? And Miyazaki was like, because girls are strong and brave.
Well, you know what? I will say this for the man. Amazing self-restraint. I mean, seriously, like if I received that question, I don't think I would be like, I don't think I would even understand it, you know.
You'd be like, "Hold my jacket."
I was like, "What?" I was like, "Hey, excuse me, this is more of a comment than a question." That does remind me, one time I actually went to see a talk by Bruce Campbell of Evil Dead fame. And he was taking audience questions. And he said, all right, I'm going to take one more question. And someone says, okay, and the last question was, when's there going to be another Evil Dead sequel? And Bruce Campbell, like, paused, and he kind of looked into the ether, you know, kind of stroking his chin, and he said, when will there be another Evil Dead sequel? I pause because this is such an unusual question. I've never been asked this before. And then he just turns to the audience and says, I'm going to take another last question because that was a poor question. That was a very, very poor question. I always thought that was very funny. Kind of a dick move, but at the same time, I mean, I can't really blame him because it's like, come on. How many times has he been asked that?
That guy went home and hung himself.
Well, Bruce Campbell was very nice to me, though. He signed my book.
Good. Good.
That's the important thing. Fuck that other guy. Should have asked a better question. I don't know why people ask questions, these things, anyway. They never have good ones. It's like, no. It's not like I'm like, oh, I'm I'm going to go to Bruce Campbell talk. I better study his entire oeuvre so I can say something, so I can come up with a really good question. It's like, I'm sorry, you're not like working for the New Yorker. You're not going to have a good question to ask him. You know, mm-hmm. you just want to get up and hear your voice and have him say something in response. You can be like, hey, I talked to Bruce Campbell, you know, but yeah. I don't think I've ever heard anyone. I've been to lots of these talks and no one ever asks good questions. I do remember like one time I went to like the Star Trek convention. Like there was I wouldn't say a good question, but kind of a cool moment. Like some guy was talking to, asking Geordi LaForge a question, not Geordi LaForge, the man who plays Geordi LaForge.
LeVar Burton.
Thank you. LeVar Burton, who is, probably one of the nicest people in the entire world, you know?
I'm sure I can't imagine, you know, him not being one of the nicest people in the world.
I mean, every interaction I've seen, it's like, oh, he's literally LeVar Burton from TV's Reading Rainbow. I guess it makes sense. He's kind of playing himself there. You know, even with the same name, but like, so he was talking, the guy who asked the question was a engineer who was blind and was talking, saying, you know, how Geordi LaForge being blind in Star Trek meant a lot to him. And he was mentioned like that he, you know, really had always wanted to like have a chance to like play with the visor. And so like LeVar Burton was like, oh, I got it right here. And he came down and like, you know, let the guy play around with it, which was, you know, kind of fun, kind of a cool little thing. I don't remember what the question was. I don't think it really mattered. It was just like, oh, it's really nice that he's like, you know, he got that opportunity.
Yeah.
Whoops. But anyway, I'm dropping stuff all over the place.
Oh.
Hopefully it wasn't important. Anyway, people ask dumb questions at these things. That's the point.
Yes.
Anyway, but tell me the
Tuba. Anyway, but if I ever get to go to a Pixar thing, I'm going to ask them, so what happened with Tubby the Tuba?
That would actually be a very good question.
Yeah, they'd probably have a lot to say that they've been ruminating on for the past 45 years.
It would be very funny if they were like, no one can know about this. they immediately like, shut the doors!
Black bag me.
No one gets out alive. Yeah. But Tubby the Tuba. So this was so I hope you all have a happy Thanksgiving. Tubatastic Thanksgiving.
Yes, and if you make tuba noises after Thanksgiving, we're not gonna complain.
Oompa, oompa.
Oompa. Let's cut it right there.